topic number one. This is something I found on a podcast episode with Donnell Rawlings. Donnell Rawlings was on the Joey Diaz podcast. And again, I think if you've watched, what have you watched? If you've watched maybe a recent Joe Rogan, Donnell Rawlings has been on there twice in a row. I think he was on by himself, and then he came on again with RZA from Wu-Tang Clan. And if you're a fan of the podcast, you'll know that it was a complete shit show with RZA because, you know, Donnell Rawlings kept interrupting every 2 seconds, which is annoying, but really funny at the same time. So definitely check that out if you're that way inclined. But he had a really good appearance on Joey Diaz's podcast, and they were, you know, really good. I always find their conversations around comedy and around making it and around chasing your dreams really inspiring. I think you can take that conversation and apply it to every area of your life, whether it's, you know, your school, whether it's at work, whatever you're doing, you can apply some of those life lessons to the stuff you're doing. And I think the fact that they're all comedians, there's a kind of intrinsic part of them where they kind of have to be honest. You have to be brutally honest to be a good comedian, I'd assume. You can't exactly, because a lot of comedians say in it, right, you have to kind of find your, let me put the camera a bit closer to me here. A lot of comedians say you have to sort of find your voice when you're doing comedy, right? You have to find your voice. You don't know who you are first when you first start. And part of the process of finding your voice is peeling back all the layers that, you know, have happened in your life, every kind of experience you've kind of buried deep down, because we all have them, right? We have those brutally tough and really painful experiences that we don't really want to relive, that we kind of bury deep inside of us. But if you're a really good comedian, what you're going to do is that you have to kind of be open and really speak about it as open as you can, so you can kind of get to the heart, get to the funny bit of it, which again is really difficult to do. So I find comedians the best source of inspiration or motivation, as opposed in terms of how to keep my eye on the prize and how to keep steadfast in my journey and just to not kind of give up, because they've gone through so many things that would, in kind of the everyday sense of the word, probably draw most people to kind of stop and just give up. Because, you know, especially the pursuit of comedy, you know, you're going up on the stage, which is intrinsically something a lot of humans are really fearful of doing. I think I remember reading somewhere that, you know, stand-up comedy or standing up on stage and speaking is the second most scary thing for most people in the world after maybe death, right? It's super scary because the thought about it is, I think someone like Chris Ryan said it from Sex at Dawn, that dude who appears sometimes on Joe Rogan. I think he mentioned something along the lines of in the prehistoric times, we had to basically, humans, our ancestors had to speak in public or in front of a crowd in order to kind of save our lives. If we committed a crime or we went, basically, you were sort of like your own lawyer in the public court of, in the public court of opinion, or public court of opinion or opinion of public court, wherever it is. So that maybe is hardwired in us. So the idea of standing up on stage is sort of like you're singing for your supper or you're singing for your life. So that's why we're scared of it. But nonetheless, it's a very scary pursuit. You're constantly having to subject yourself to embarrassment, to shame, right? To fumbling, to failing again and again and again. Loads of comedians always say that you only get good after 10 years and then you get famous maybe after 20, right? Some of the famous comedians that we know of have only really got good after, you know, 20, 30 years in the business. So it's a really hard thing to kind of go through. But that's where the honesty comes in. Anyway, going back to what Donnell Rawlings is saying, because I'm rambling a bit here, but Donnell Rawlings came on the Joe Diaz podcast and he spoke really eloquently or made a really good point that sort of like I've been thinking about a bit here, and I think I tweeted it somewhere here. Let me see if I can find it. He tweeted something that I kind of made a comment I thought was really cool. So this is a tweet that I thought was really interesting from Donnell Rawlings on the Joe Diaz podcast. I've got it up on here on my screen for my own Twitter profile. I know it's a bit narcissistic, but forgive me. Oh, don't forgive me. It's my own podcast. I can do what I want. So it says the following. In this business, comedy, Donnell Rawlings quote on Joe Diaz podcast, in this business, comedy, you have to be willing to do what the next man won't do or hasn't thought about, or you'll end up just being some regular motherfucker. And again, it's advice that we're all probably familiar with. I don't think he's saying anything too that much different than what we've probably heard in all our years, you know, kind of going through life. You know that for the most part, if you want to stand out, even in the job interviews, right? Standing out in job interviews is probably one of the best lessons that you can learn in that regard, especially when it comes to roles that are pretty easy to get, or roles that a lot of people have the same skin. And I think when it's the roles that are like at the higher echelon in terms of pay bracket, they might call for a certain level of experience, so it completely you know, takes you out of the equation because you're just not old enough, or it requires a certain level of expertise out of the equation as well because you haven't done, you haven't been in enough jobs. There's certain things that get you out of the blue, but most roles, the stuff that I do, marketing assistant, community manager, social media manager, for the most part, anyone can do that, right? There's probably not much difference between somebody that's been 3 years in a job of being a marketing assistant and somebody that's been 5 years in a job of being a marketing assistant. So when you get those kind of interviews, you essentially have to compete with that person on the equal playing field, but you're gonna have to make yourself stand out because the experience isn't enough. Because you both demonstrated 3 year and 5 year marketing assistant person. You both demonstrated you can do the job. You both know how to post on social. You both know how to make a content calendar. You both know how to write copy, write blogs, whatever, right? You have a good overview of the marketing landscape. You are great people. So you have to stand out in other ways. And that's where you kind of learn, like, you know, how to be charismatic, how to speak, how to carry yourself. Maybe you do some research on a company and you highlight some things that you've probably seen in areas of growth. Maybe you bring a presentation, you bring a slide, you bring a deck, whatever it may be. You have to do little things to kind of differentiate yourself so they can remember you when they are making their overall decisions, because, you know, most of the interviews are done by a committee and stuff. So life is usually like that. But it can get difficult, right? It can get hard. It can get quite tiring. And I think even with me, with my whole DJing stuff that I've been doing, which is kind of the singular pursuit that I've been kind of exploring, mostly as a hobby, but, you know, if I have an option to take this to the moon and back, I'll be more than happy to. Same with the podcasting, right? If I have a possibility to kind of cash out and make all my income solely through the podcast, I'd be happy to do that too. But I've realized too, like, you know, doing a podcast and uploading it numerous amounts of times in a week, and, you know, maybe not getting the plays or listens that you probably aim to get, can get quite disheartening, right? But then I think for me personally, I look at most of these exercises as just a necessary path as to where I want to get to. Like, you have to go through this. I don't think anyone, unless you're a celebrity, and even if you're a celebrity, you know, I've heard, for instance, like the comedian Whitney Cummings has recently started a podcast, and I heard her complaining just recently about her views, right? She was like, oh, I've only got 60,000 views or something. So I'm assuming if you're a Whitney Cummings and you're used to appearing on Joe Rogan's podcast and seeing your views climb up in the hundreds of thousands or the millions, to suddenly have your own platform and it be 60, it might as well be 16,000. It might as well be 10. It might as well be 2 plays. I get it. It's all kind of relative. But I think it's a necessary path. I don't think anyone starts, you know, I look back sometimes at those old Joe Rogan videos of him talking in a webcam with his friends on a settee in his house. Those videos, even though he might have had some kind of notoriety coming into it, being on TV and stuff and being a UFC commentator, you still have to start from zero. There is no other way to kind of get to the top. You have to start from zero. So you just have to kind of grit your teeth and just go through it. It's just a necessary part of the journey. And then I went back and looked at some of my DJ gigs that I played back in the day, right? And I looked back at some of the history that I've done, some of the things that I've played at, and just, I was just like, it kind of took me back again. I was like, bloody hell, man, I've gone through some absolute bullcrap. So I think I'm close to approaching 10 years DJing on my own, right? Solo kind of thing. Maybe I'd say consistently the last 5 years, but overall I've been DJing for 10 years. And I looked at my stuff, my listings on RA, because I always try to put all my listings on there because I don't want to have a whole archive of all the places I played. Mostly just all my DJ gigs are listed. So if I go on my my DJ profile on there, Handsome Black Man, I'll scroll down to events. Let me quickly put that there, get this off. Let's take this. What is this in the back here? Let's get this off as well. Let's go to events on here, and let's go into two. So this is my profile, right? My DJ profile on RA just kind of made me think about the journey that you need to go on. So the header image is me playing at So Special. No, it's me playing at the Alibi. I think at their last event, their closing party for when, you know, unfortunately, about to close down. And Alibi kind of marked a seminal moment in my journey as a DJ. That's where I kind of established myself as a promoter. Co-founded this night called So Special, which was super popular, which then sprung up to other events around town, Corner Shop, The Nest, blah, blah, blah. Loads of places around Dawson kind of had a good time there. And then, of course, that kind of fell by the wayside due to, you know, just growing up and moving on, the club moving on and wanting younger people, probably didn't connect to them as much, and then just wanted to take a different direction. Me and a co-founder of So Special kind of had a bit of a falling out. So it just didn't work out in the way that I wanted to work out. No problem. But then it will come back full circle because I got to play the last set before it closed down. And I had a good one, played loads of disco, had a really good time. So you look at that and you're like, okay, cool, that's amazing. But then you scroll down to 2010 when I kind of first started, but it was, you know, a little bit before. I think it was in 2009, my actual official date, but I can't actually find that. And I got so special there, right? But I scroll up to 2011. I think it's 2011. There's an event here that I did, right? It's got an epic story towards it. What can I find? 2014, 15? What is it? It's not that. It was a weird event that I played, right? That was absolutely horrendous. I don't know if I can find it right now. Kind of fresh, not that one. Oh, I can't find it. Damn it. I had it on here, really. Anyway, there was an event that I played, anyway, let's say around 2010. It wasn't then, but it was another event that was probably one of the worst, if not the worst, event that I've ever played in my life. It was in central London. The promoter that helped that wind us to play, I'm not sure how you got in contact with him. I think he found us maybe through Facebook or something. Emailed us, told us to come and DJ. We went to go play at some bougie kind of cocktail bar somewhere in Soho, one of those kind of basement bars full of like neon lights and glass and mirrors everywhere to make it look bigger. I know that kind of illusion, that kind of interior design illusion where they put mirrors everywhere to make it look more spacious, but it doesn't actually work. Full of loads of bottle girls. So immediately it wasn't our scene. And this, you can imagine, right? If you think I'm a hipster now, I looked worse, or I looked more corny back then, right? I was a proper, fully fledged Brick Lane, buying my stuff from like Beyond Retro, Rocket, wearing those fucking plimsolls, Vans with white socks, like just, you know, I can like pretending I'd smoked cigarettes when I actually didn't, just fucking go, right? Not inhaling it at all. Just a disaster of a kid, right? But enjoying myself, having a good time. So imagine us kind of rocking up to a Soho bar and DJing there, right? So obviously we're playing, it's an early set, you know, no one's actually there. By the time people come in, they have their own friends playing the fucking highlight set. So they basically get us to warm up, and then essentially they don't pay us by the end of the night, right? And they do this thing that I never knew existed, and I only found out it was a common thing after the fact. The co-founder dude that this was special with kind of told me, hey, they're not going to come back, right? Because I kept waiting around for them, thinking they were going to come back to give us the money. And they essentially stayed away for 8. I don't know how they did it. I don't know if it's a particular thing promoters do, but they were around when we were playing. They when we went to go get paid, we couldn't find them. And then when we tried to find them, every time we tried to find them, they would always be in a rush. Oh, hold on one sec, I've got to go do this. They were always running around. So they never stopped 1 minute for us to talk to them. But it wasn't like it was done in a very subtle way. You just couldn't pin them down to like say, hey, where's my fucking money? They always kept moving, right? They were like they were like a fish in your hands, like a slippery eel. Just kept slipping out. Just when you think you got it in your hand, boom, it pops out. So that happened, and then we kept waiting around, and it didn't happen. And by the end of it, we just get frustrated, and I kind of go home in a strop, and we never got paid, right? Called them at the end, emailed them, no reply, no money. So they inevitably just finessed us out of the P. Cool, that shit happens. But then I remember it was funny when I realized I wasn't the only one, because I remember watching an episode of Atlanta years after, and there's an episode in Atlanta where Childish Gambino's character is trying to get paid, trying to get his artist paid, and they're in a club, and the guy basically, and they do it perfectly. Like the promoter keeps, he always keeps like running away, like drifting away. There's like millions of people in between him. Every time the Charles Gambino character says, "Hey, where's the money?" He's be like, one minute, I'll be with you, one second, and he just keeps slipping away, disappearing into the crowds. And I think finally he does pin him down, and he gives him, I think, half of the money or some of it. But then, you know, reading up on it a bit more, you realize that's a common thing that people go through. Even the most high caliber of artists go through that same sort of thing. Just for snaky promoters. Some of the rationale behind it is that sometimes if a promoter puts on an event, let's say with Cardi B, and they don't get the turnout they expected, but they paid Cardi B, a gazillion pounds, whatever it may be, they probably know that if they pay Cardi B this money, they'll be in the black. They won't make any P whatsoever. So they kind of refuse to pay in that regard because they didn't make the money back. But again, it's not Cardi B's fault. If you hired me for an event, you pay my fee. So I just remember just having that whole event playing in my head and thinking, wow, man, that was equivalent to what I'm going through now with my podcast. It's just the early stages of it. You have to just do a lot of it, a lot of reps. And then suddenly it will get to a point where I'm at a level where, you know, I'll be complaining about the next thing or whatever it may be. But it's just a process I have to go through, as simple as that. And I think I wouldn't be DJing as often as I am now every month. You know, my next event is at the Heathcote and Star, which is, I think, listed on here, isn't it, right? Heathcote and Star on the 21st, I think, of December. So yeah, I wouldn't be DJing every month that I am now if I hadn't gone through that period of time, if I hadn't gone through those janky promoters, those horrible situations. And yeah, I guess it's just a message for anyone listening, you know, don't get what you call it, don't get beaten up by the process. The process is exactly what it is. It's an absolute process. It can take a lot out of you. It can really demotivate you, but it shouldn't. It should actually put a fire in your belly, and it should actually make you know. And I think the more you struggle, the more you should be aware that this is exactly where you should be. Because it's very unlikely that you're in a position where you're like an overnight success and it goes from like 0 to 100. It doesn't usually happen that way. It usually happens, you might get an overnight exposure, overnight maybe look, maybe overnight cosign, but that doesn't mean you weren't doing your work like, you know, 5-10 years in the trenches beforehand. So you always have to be kind of quote unquote ready. And that's what I always wanted to be. That's kind of always been my dream. Like, imagine if sometime, imagine if I have an occasion, imagine if I get to a point in my life where I suddenly get friendly with somebody from Printworks, or, you know, somebody from X or Y becomes my friend, or something happens, right? No, they stumble on the video and they're like, oh shit, this guy's cool, let me book him to play a warm-up set. I just want to be ready. I don't want to talk a big game and act like I want to be on that platform, and then when I get like a lucky shot, oh, someone's sick, someone's flight got cancelled, I'm not prepared to like play. I have to be prepared at all occasions to show up, show out, and show exactly why I belong on that platform, or why I belong exactly on that stage that everyone else is playing. And I think that's what applies to everyone as well. So don't get disheartened. This is the process. It is what it is. You have to kind of go through it. And hopefully over time, you will get to a place where, you know, you're in a position that you want to be. But again, the process is the process.